Our next speaker is Achyuta Ghosh, who heads research and mobility at NASSCOM. In his current role, he actively works on developing the roadmap in technology areas such as artificial intelligence, IoT, blockchain, robotics, and virtual reality for the Indian IT BPM industry. He also focuses on building the mobility ecosystem in India through partnerships with multiple stakeholders. Prior to NASSCOM, Achyuta led the smart cities business for Ford Smart Mobility in India, where he collaborated with Indian smart cities to understand their unique transportation challenges and designed innovative solutions. He has also worked in technology organizations such as Frost & Sullivan, Genpact, and WNS in various leadership consulting roles. Please welcome Achyuta on stage.
Good morning, everyone. So I think a lot of the speakers today and yesterday would cover digital transformation. I want to cover something which underlays digital transformation, data. This is a topic which is very close to my heart and also NASSCOM. We are working very closely with the Prime Minister's Office and Niti Aayog to deliver a national data strategy. We are terming it data to value. We all agree with the quote on the slide, right? The world's most valuable resource is no longer oil, but it's data. That's something that the economists put out in 2017. So before we get started, a quick brief about NASSCOM. We are India's largest tech trade body, 2,700 plus members, and about 90% of the industry revenues. The underlying mission is very, very simple. We want to help the technology, software, products, and services industry in India to be trustworthy and innovative across the world. This actually leads us into three areas. The first is nurturing India's innovation capacity. The second is building the ecosystem for tech. And the third is to create new markets for the Indian trade industry. If we go a bit deeper, what it means is continuously strengthen the IT industry narrative, tell the story of the Indian IT industry to the world in different forums, in different markets such as this. Second is to develop the skilling platform within India, digital skills, traditional skills, how do we make India the best skilling location in the world. The third piece is to work on the ecosystem, whether it is government, academia, startups, large enterprises, how do we get them together? The fourth piece is to help expansion of the Indian IT industry, the third-party industries outside of India, and the captives in the MNC into India. The fourth piece is to work with the government to drive more technology adoption into India itself. Look at nascent sectors such as healthcare, manufacturing, agriculture, how can we drive more technology within India? And the last piece is to enable safe regulations so that India is trustworthy, innovative, and there is enough of security in the place. Just wanted to kick off by showing this diagram. I think many of you would have seen it in the past. A quick capture of how 1 minute on the internet looks like. And it's not all hunky-dory, by the way. Some of the platforms are going exponentially. The Netflix platform, for example, it's grown by 9 times in the last 2 years. We in the industry are quite happy with a 10% growth or a 15% growth. Here we are talking about 9 times growth in 2 years. Something like Instagram has grown by 6 times in the last 2 years. So these are exponential growth platforms. People spending money on the internet, shopping on the internet, that number has grown up by 40% in the last 2 years. So more and more people are spending money on the internet. Some of the platforms are stable. Things like, say, Google, Facebook, they're more or less constant, slight amount of growth. Voice, do you see the number there? Number of smart speakers shipped in 1 minute. That has grown by about three times in the last 3 years. People are increasingly using voice to converse and transact. If you look at Snapchat, it's actually degrown. So it's not all hunky-dory for all digital platforms, but you see winners, you see people who are steady, you see some who are not. Which brings us to the question, is there a need for national data strategy? Or do we just let things, you know, work out the way it's working out? We believe there is a need. First, data is driving wealth creation. In the manufacturing age, capital was very important. In the IP age, in the license, software licensing age, IP was very important. today, data is the most important factor driving growth. The top five companies in the world are all data-driven organizations. You have Google, Facebook, Amazon, Apple, Microsoft. They are all data-driven organizations to start with. Research also shows that a country which is more open to data flows, which is more participative to global data flows, actually has a huge impact on GDP, almost 50% higher GDP compared to those who are not. Data is growing exponentially, the second trend. 90% of all the data in the world was created in the last 2 years. And we believe that 25% of the world GDP is digitally impacted, is data driven. The third piece, there is a lot of data asymmetry. And the data asymmetry is actually, we believe, is killing innovation. When I say data asymmetry, it is all about the people who are generating the infrastructure for data. They control the end of all an end of data. There's no sharing protocols, and there is no downstream innovation. So that is what we term as data asymmetry. At the same time, data is not a commodity. In India, in a lot of countries, it's treated as commodity, but then data belongs to the owner. And we need to have regulations. We need to be sensitive about how we use them. Last but not the least, we as a country, a lot of countries talk about national AI strategy, but what is national AI strategy without having a national data strategy in place? Because that's what will underline your AI strategy. This is a chart that actually shows gross data producing countries in the world, GDP. There's a new terminology for GDP. You see the rankings that are in the bubbles. This is calculated by HBR. I just picked up the research from them. We are taking into account the absolute volume of data. The proxy for that is broadband consumption. We are also taking into account accessibility of data. The proxy for that is speed, average speed of data. The third piece is data usage, how much of data is being used, how many people are using it. And the fourth piece is complexity. We are using a proxy for complexity by taking per capita consumption of data. You divide the total amount of data consumed by a country divided by number of people in the country. This is how the rankings come in. No brainer, US is number one. It scores highly on all the four parameters: volume, accessibility, usage, and complexity. Number two is UK. It'll probably score low on the volume, but on the other three parameters, it's pretty high. Number three is China, all four volumes. Number 24 is India. India is quite low. The volume is high, but the accessibility is low. The usage is also low. The complexity is also low because a lot of population and not enough usage. But this is probably the new world order when it comes to measuring countries, right? We have GDP, gross domestic product, but here we're talking about GDP as gross data product. Any guesses what these three countries are? The second one is easy, right? Yep. The first one? Yep, I heard it. Right. So there are three examples that I want to cover, the first being Denmark. This is about country data strategies that Denmark put in. So they, in 2011, they established something called as Danish Agency for Digitization, DAD. Okay. The aim was to digitally transform the government. That was the aim that they established. And what they also started was something called as the Mandatory Digital Post. This Mandatory Digital Post is an interesting idea. They set a goal that 80 to 90% of all communication with the government and the citizens will be digital. And they achieved that in 5 years. How did they achieve it? Because they invested strongly on a basic data program. The basic data program ensured uniformity of collection of data so that there was no repeatability, no format issues. And also they bought a lot of data sets into the purview, weather data, infrastructure data, utility data, population data. All those data sets came under basic data program, and that actually enabled the Mandatory Digital Post initiative to succeed, and they succeeded in their goals that about 90% of communication between the government and citizens became digital. United Kingdom has a very similar example. Same time frame, 2011, they set up Government Digital Services, GDS. Same target to digitally transform the government. But they went in a different direction. They established something called as the GDS Exemplar Program. In the Exemplar Program, the government, the GDS, identified 25 areas or 25 departments which saw a lot of transactions happening. Then set a goal for itself that I will give myself 400 days, 400 days to transform these 25 areas digitally. The focus was on speed, the focus was on failing fast, but delivering at the end what citizens are looking for. And they did it, by the way. Out of the 25 departments selected, 16 were delivered in that 400-year period, in 2 years, 2016. The remaining departments that they targeted, they also came on board over the next 1 year or so. UK also went forward and also established a center for data ethics. I mean, you can keep collecting data, but there has to be an ethical way to analyze data, use data. So UK went ahead and established that. My favorite example is the third country, Estonia, small country, 1.5 million people, right? You probably have more in this hotel than as compared to Estonia. They had a four-pronged approach to digitization. First, they established a digital national population register. Every citizen of Estonia has a unique alphanumeric code assigned to that individual. The second is they established a data layer. It's called X-Road Data Exchange. The data layer connects different public and private data sources. The third piece that they put was something similar to our Aadhaar. They had a digital identity card issued for every individual. And then the most important piece is the fourth piece, which they call as once only principle. In once only principle, any department or the Estonia government asking for any information from a citizen, they only do it once. Imagine the number of times you've given your birth date or your phone number or your name or your address to different private or public entities. In Estonia, you only give it once. And that then goes through the X-Road data exchange. People, if they want that information, they query you with your national population register number and your digital identification card, through which they can get all the data sets from your X-Road data exchange. So this is how the entire system works. The amount of efficiency that came into the system cannot be, you know, spoken about. I mean, the entire e-governance infrastructure just shot through the roof. The usage of e-governance really shot through the roof once the once only principle came in. I think any country trying to establish a data strategy needs to look at these kind of goals and these kind of principles, governing principles. What are inherent benefits of a data-driven nation, right? You look at the filter of citizens, corporations, and country. For a country, definitely inclusive GDP growth, right? Right now, a lot of the countries, the GDP growth is extremely imbalanced. So how does the GDP growth translate to other sections of the society? How can the government give better public services, better governance services, whether citizen services? Will it lead to higher productivity? Will it lead to higher utilizations? Of course, yes, because data usage will actually drive a lot of intelligence in decision making and resource allocation. Think about agriculture. One of the reports I read actually said that there can be a $9 billion impact to farmers' income if agri-tech actually is more pervasive in India. Increasing trade power. We talked about the GDP, the gross data producers. So once the country is able to collect data together, does that give it a trade advantage? Can there be international exchange of data? Can data be a commodity? Select set of data, can it be a commodity? And can it add to the value of foreign exchange that flows into the nation? And of course, enhance national security. If you look at corporations, if you look at enterprises, it's talking about more innovation, talks about more business areas that you can transform. Imagine if people had access to half of Google's data, how many startups will come in? How many organizations will benefit from that and create businesses? More competitive markets, there would be more competition. Today we are in an age of monopoly in a lot of these businesses. Existing business opportunities will also improve because innovation from other areas will actually flow into the existing businesses. And of course, we will be able to develop our local capabilities, local market capabilities. For our citizens, it means better quality of life. It means more social growth. It also means personalized services. Maybe lower cost of services also because volumes will start kicking in. It will lead to jobs, definitely. We all want jobs. And of course, transparency and accountability. So a lot of benefits that a national data strategy can drive. Why do we believe that India is at a position to benefit or leapfrog in this data-driven economy. We have strengths, huge amount of connected population, large amount of data volumes. Data volumes is expected to rise 10 times in the next 2 years. Today it's 6 GB per head, it's going to be about 56. We have actually demonstrated innovation at scale through the Jan Dhan, Aadhaar, mobile network. There's a lot of tech talent already in the industry, and there are a lot of tech talent in the colleges which are coming out every year. What are our weaknesses? I think our weaknesses, we all know, the tech implementation that we do is very siloed. We don't take into account a system level view, we take into account a process level view or a specific outcome level view. We lack standards. Everything happens customized. I mean, you go to a city or you go to any state, everybody does it in a different manner. There is no interoperability. It's okay if you do it in a different manner, but can it be interoperable? No, that also does not exist. So even that needs to be defined. And there is very low R&D investment in India as compared to other organizations, other countries across the world. What are threats? Two threats, regulation and competition. If we improperly regulate this market, this will impact our participation in the global data economy, and that will have an impact on GDP. If we delay, the competition will move forward. The competition has already started moving forward. Why do we say it's good? There are a lot of opportunities. Huge amount of innovation happening in India. More than 7,000 startups already in the space. And this market has not yet opened up. The data market has not yet opened up. This will actually probably do a 2x, 3x multiplier to the overall number of startups in India. Cost of technology adoption is still lower in India as compared to other countries. So we can actually do it at lower cost. Time. Data strategy is not something that can be solved today, tomorrow, or next 1 year. We need to have a long-term strategy. We need to have a long-term play. So time is on our hands, but we need to get started quickly. And the fourth is there is a very top-down commitment. We have had conversations with the Prime Minister himself. There's a lot of top-down commitment from the PM himself to drive this agenda. I want to share something which we think can be an illustrative data strategy framework. On the left-hand side, you see the data. Stakeholders. You've got the data creators, which is the bottom, the public and citizens. Then you've got the data aggregators, and these are private and public. The third category is the data governance organizations. Some of them exist. Some of them we need to put in place. And the fourth category is something that would be a central level India data think tank. The India data think tank will work with the data governance organizations individually to ensure that the information that we collect, first public and then probably private data also coming in, flows into data exchanges. Once it flows into the data exchanges, it goes through another three filters, where it is made secure, where it is anonymized so that your identity is safe, and it is aggregated to come up with data outputs, which probably companies, organizations can use, select data sets that can be given to those organizations, which they can use to develop their own services or improve the life of Indians in India. Some considerations. First, would data governance be centralized or federated? Would it be at a state level or a national level? Would it be something like what the Indian Smart City Mission is, where there was a Smart City Mission at the national level, but then it got federated into cities and states driving it, but at the same time, the Smart City Mission maintains some amount of directional control over the program. Who's going to be the data owner? There's a lot of debate around it. Today, the data policy framework, policy bill kind of indicates that the owner is the user, is the person who generates, it's the citizen who generates the information, and the state or the public is a custodian of the service. Anybody who's aggregating the information is the custodian of the service. So does that mean we need to have a social contract with the individual? Maybe I may be willing to share my information for data aggregation, but you may not be willing to share that. So should there be social contracts in place for sharing of information, sharing of data? Third, open data exchanges. They do not exist as of now. We have to configure them. We have to think how we can enable safe, at the same time, legal data sharing. Not everything goes out, but only data sets that are identified and aggregated are being pushed out. Fourth, interoperability and standards. How do we break the silos? How do we create rules which will ensure that whatever information we create can be used in multiple ways? Fifth, We have done all the data cleaning and aggregation. Then we have to find a market for it. So what's the market? How do we value data? Is it valued in bytes, in valued in particular sets? Where do we value it? How does the trading happen? International, within the country, you know, who buys, who sells? So the market economics will need to be, have been proved. Fourth, we have to identify the privacy paradox, right? We have to ensure that data privacy exists, yet extract economic value from data. So that's the paradox that we have to solve. So how do we do it? I mean, a very basic agenda. First, you establish a chief data officer. You establish a team. You establish a set of people who will identify the roadmap for this kind of an action. Roles and responsibilities. What is my investments required? What is my go-to-market plan for this? Second, you create infrastructures, processes, frameworks in which you aggregate data, anonymize data. You set your standards, and you create business models. Third, you pilot. And the best way to pilot is probably to use public data sets. I would expect private data players to come in later, but how do I work with what I already have in hand? Identify two or three high impact areas, and then do a quick POC to establish the entire business model. Sorry. And the fourth one is to, once you have succeeded in doing a few pilots, how do you quickly scale? And that's where you get public-private partnerships going. That's where you try to see whether you can get a global data exchange going where India works with other countries to exchange and drive data exchanges. How does it tie in with our national AI platform strategy, right? And also that includes the R&D angle. So just to summarize, I think we are moving from a knowledge-driven economy to a data-driven economy. That was the first thought we shared. The second thought is that just by producing data, you will not become the leader in this space. You have to have the ability to convert the data to value. How do you convert the data to value? Data economics will actually change the rules of competition. You will actually find a new set of competing countries, a top-level countries coming in that ranking actually showed. The race to data leadership has already started. A lot of countries are already, you know, moving forward. They are getting private-public partnerships together. They are actually working to extract value from data. We are behind. We need to move forward very fast. We believe that India has the building blocks to gain competitive advantage. NASSCOM believes that there needs to be a national-level strategy, not a haphazard siloed strategy. And that's the reason why we propose an approach like this, which will benefit all the three C's, citizen, country, and corporations, to build a connected, secure, and innovative India. I'd like to leave with a quote. Thank you.